morning, everyone. Welcome to the call. Anita, it's so good to see you. We're so excited to hear from you and learn from you. It's so good to see everybody. Heather, I'm going to turn this over to you.
Hi, everyone. I'm very excited to announce Anita. I met Anita, was it over a little over a year ago? Her and I are in the Santa Rosa Leadership group. So she's always been near and dear to my heart. And then she actually worked for another nonprofit, and now she's with SAY, and I had the pleasure of serving on the board of SAY as well. And I've been there for about 2 months now, and I've learned so much and so proud of this nonprofit and what they've done and what Anita's done. And so I can't wait for her to share her story and also the SAY story. So Anita, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you, everybody, and good morning. Thank you for that kind introduction, Heather. We have to get together for that cocktail real soon. So Bianca and the rest of the Be Better platform, thank you so much for providing me the opportunity to talk a little bit more about what we do here at Social Advocates for Youth. Again, good morning, everyone. As Heather mentioned, I am the new CEO at Social Advocates for Youth. I've only been in this position for about a year and a couple weeks. I started in March 2nd of 2020, and I think a week and a half later, we were in pandemic mode. And so it's been a real interesting ride throughout this last year, but I've learned so much just from my team, the way that we operate, and the awesome board of directors and their support in helping us make it through this very difficult year that I'm sure each of you have had as well. What's really in the center of our core values, and that's putting the youth voices first. We integrate that in everything that we do. And as you'll see in all of the work that we've done over the past 50 years, we were founded in 1971 by a group of legendary Sonoma County leaders. And we're celebrating a great milestone that I'll tell you about, our 50th anniversary. And we'll tell you a little bit about that at the end of my presentation. But this wonderful group of folks got together because they noticed a high incarceration rate among runaway youth and recognized that there were few alternatives other than juvenile hall. At that time, it was illegal for a young person to run away. So those who were fleeing from unsafe family situations and environments were sent to juvenile hall rather than alternative methods for us to address them, to address the root problems. So SAY was born. And since then, we've served 60,000 children, youth, and families since our founding. Annually, we serve around 3,000 children, youth, and their families. And we do that through four core services. And we'll talk a little bit about each of these here in my presentation. Crisis stabilization, where we meet youth where they're at, counseling, housing, and careers. We have about a $7 million budget. And the percentage split of that between earned and unearned revenue is about 78-22. And what that means is that 70% of our budget or our revenue comes from government contracts, federal contracts, and 22% of that comes from donors and members of the community. At any point in time, there are 100 young people sleeping under any of our roofs, and we own four particular buildings. People know us the most from our SAY Dream Center located here on Hone in Summerfield. We also have Tamayo Village, Coffee Teen House Shelter, and our newest addition to the SAY family, the SAY Family Cottage. But at this point, what we know is there are about 304 living on the streets. What we do know from the data that we collect is that 37% of our youth really report physical, emotional, or sexual abuse that led to their homelessness. I'm gonna let this one sit for a second. 33% of our youth reported trading drugs or sex for a safe place to stay. And 31% of our youth reported their safety was threatened in the past 30 days. We also know that a significant number of youth, 33%, identify as being LGBTQ. At SAY, that percentage is a little higher. And it's 48% of the youth in our housing services that identify as that. We know that's a really big reason as to why they go out on the streets. It's because their families, they kick them out because they identify as LGBTQ. So I mentioned street outreach. What is street outreach? Street outreach is, you know, the only outreach program for homeless youth in the county, and we operate that. We have a team of trained young people, often with lived experience, to actually go out same time, same day, to a location that we advertise on Facebook and other social media, so that the youth can see us consistently. And with that, we bring, you know, hygiene products, food, socks, you know, condoms, things of that nature for them to stay safe out there. We also deal with, and we have two beds set aside for sexually trafficked youth. And we do, and we are trained in sex traffic intervention and prevention. I'm proud to say that our team of only 4 people in California who have completed a certificate in human trafficking, all of them are from SAY. And in fact, 2 of our managers have the advanced certificate from the same body here, which is the McCain Institute for International Leadership. And, you know, we get questions all the time, like, you know, we have sexually trafficked youth here. We do. And it's typically comes through the, I think it's the 580 and the 101 corridor. And they're usually people outside of Sonoma County who come in. And, you know, many people say, well, I don't see it. Well, it is meant for people not to be seen. They go in the shadows, and it does happen. And it's an unfortunate part of, you know, some of the work that we have to deal with our young people. We always, we have a 24/7 youth crisis hotline, and it's the only one in the county. And then we also support youth in community-based housing. This is what a street outreach kit looks like. Typically it has snacks, socks, hats, cleaning wipes, feminine hygiene products, flashlight and batteries. But really the point in doing that is not only giving them things to make them safe, it's also about building relationships. What we hear from our young people is that they typically have never had an adult that has been consistent in their life that they couldn't trust. So trust and relationship building is an important piece of the work of our street outreach team. Another major part of what we do, and many people maybe don't really know SAY for counseling, is we have a robust counseling services. We offer 3 main specific areas in our counseling department. We offer therapy for children, youth, and their families. And it's offered typically in a pre-pandemic world, would have been at the Dream Center. Now we've pivoted to telehealth housing. We have, as I said, 4 SAY buildings. Our Dream Center are for young people ages 18 to 24. And once they're here, we really take advantage of that by providing them the supports that they need, including case management, rental supports. We have about 51 bed capacity pre-COVID. Post-COVID, of course, with the social distancing, you know, we have capacity to serve less people because of the guidelines. So how did we pivot and how did we use innovation to change the way that we conduct our programs and services, but without having a break in that? Because we are considered an essential provider. As a congregate living facility, we knew that we had to make changes that were in guidance with the CDC requirements, but also we had to keep our staff and our youth really, really safe, because while we all go home to our own homes, this is the place that our young people call home. And so if there was a super spreader here at any of our facilities, they would be back on the streets because they have nowhere else to go. So the first thing that we did is that we increased hygiene at all of our facilities and really not only educated our staff about safety protocols, but about our youth. You know, our youth, they have their rights, and the best that we can do is to try to keep them socially distant. Many of them have their own rooms, but many of them share living spaces like showers and they eat together. And so all of that had to be separated. The beds in our short-term living area had to be separated to comply with the 6 feet apart. We had to take away the congregate eating. And so we had to serve them individually in individual trays, for example. You know, our young people, they're social creatures. They want to be around each other. So it was quite a challenge. But, you know, it's something that our staff has done, I think, extremely well. Finally, I'll end with, you know, 50 years of service in Sonoma County. We've been here for 50 years. We're concentrating on really looking at ways to be sustainable for 50 years and beyond. And we just engaged in a strategic planning process that we're just finishing up that really, really focuses on the sustainability of the work that we do, really honing in the support of the community and really looking for always better ways to serve the young people that need us the most. So with that being said, I am happy to entertain any questions that you may have.